Coming up on this episode of The Roundtable.
As much of anything.
He's defending Cecil Rhodes.
What
I'm also triggered.
Also canceled.
rather than defending Cecil Rhodes, I'm suggesting that the deep-seated desire to remove statues of people of a bygone technological age is perhaps rooted in something gasp even more powerful than racial animus.
Became wealthy and it's the place where the California Gold Rush started.
If they want to rename Sutter's Creek, I'm marching on the on Amador County. Much to say, but man, I still think them cats are crazy. They were asking if you were around, how you was, where you could be found. I told them you were living downtown, driving all the old men crazy. The boys are back in town, the boys are back in town. Welcome everyone once again to the Roundtable, the editors and publishers podcast of The American Mind here at the Claremont Institute. I'm your host, Ryan Williams, publisher of The American Mind, the Claremont Review of Books, and president of the Claremont Institute. And I'm happy to report the gang is back all together.
Boys are back in town.
Everyone's in the office, except for David, who's in Maryland as usual.
Crowded.
Holler back to our first episode. To my left, Matthew Peterson, Vice President of Education, founding editor of The American Mind. Next to him, James Polis, executive editor of The American Mind. And on the other side of the table, we're all socially distanced-ish, Spencer Clavin, assistant editor of The American Mind and the Claremont Review of Books, and then David Barr, managing editor of The American Mind, joining us, as always, by Zoom. Well, welcome, everybody. It's fun to be back together, some semblance of normalcy. But we wanted to set this up with the latest ad. Actually, it's not the latest. There's another one out since this one dropped. But I thought it was a particularly mendacious piece of work from the Lincoln Project, which is this collection of anti-Trump. It's too charitable to them to call them conservatives or Republicans at all. But this assortment of putative right-wingers who are disgusted by Trump and are doing their best through paid media to oust him. We're going to cut into this ad midway. First, you have some nice piano and a voiceover, slightly older gentleman voiceover, talking about the voices of inclusion and nobility. He hasn't quite put it that way, but that's what it means. And you've got Martin Luther King Jr. in his wonderfully poetic, sing-songy preacher tones, and then RFK, and then it cuts to this.
Now those who divide speak.
And I say segregation now, segregation tomorrow, and segregation forever.
I agree that looters ought to be shot, yes.
On sight?
On sight. The Negro and white citizen of this state are against the breakdown of law and order.
You have to dominate the streets. Please don't be too nice. Very fine people on both sides.
When you hear leaders speak, you know who they are, who they represent, and what kind of America they'll create. The Lincoln Project is responsible for the content of this advertising.
So I find that all pretty ironic. I've been working on a piece as a follow-up to our America is Not Racist. I won't reveal any surprise details, but needless to say, it seems in my mind, given the nature of the philosophical claims, the rhetorical claims of the two antagonists or big players in this national freakout we're having, that is Black Lives Matter and President Trump. I think the party closer to George Wallace is Black Lives Matter. It may shock some of our listeners to hear me say that, but they're the ones preaching, a new racial caste system. They're the ones preaching skin color is more important than content of character. Whereas Trump, from the first inaugural, from his first inaugural, at least, well, we hope it's his first, first of two, was said as long as your heart opens up to patriotism, there's no room for prejudice, and he has preached much closer to the founding ideal of equal rights under the law for all than some of his antagonists in the growing identity politics movement. I know no one pitches it that way, and certainly the news doesn't talk about it that way, but I submit that a close reading of Trump's public statements on any number of topics will reveal that, and just compare it to the language coming out of Black Lives Matter officially or their newest experiment in street governance happening at the Chaz/Chop in Seattle, which the central political organizer of which was a Black Lives Matter young lady. So I just wanted to throw that out there for discussion. I think the avatars of racial division in this country today are not occupying the White House. I think they're, some of them are critics of the White House.
Well, if you can tell who someone is based on what they say, when you hear things coming out of the chaz like "we're the police now," you know, I think it's pretty apparent what we're dealing with. I'm not sure though that you know that ads like this, cut by the media party for the enjoyment of the media party, are going to move that many notes at the end of the day. I mean, it's so inside baseball to begin with, just with the quotes that they chose and, you know, sort of dog whistling to people who work inside of major media corporations. But whether it's this or, you know, Chris Cuomo, how many votes is Chris Cuomo going to swing this election season? You know, it all just seems like an enormous exercise in self-dealing and propaganda. And no matter what goes down, in November, and for whatever reason, I can't help but feel like this is all a sort of curtain call for a certain kind of fantasy-driven politics.
I think you're right, James. When you put it that way, I just watched this. I can't remember if they label it telling you who everybody is, but unless they do it very prominently and for a long time, I think most of the audience will be completely left cold by why they should recognize or feel gravity towards. Well, nobody will feel much sympathy for George Wallace, but they're not going to know who George Wallace is. I mean, MLK is noticeably, people will notice who he is, I think, for the most part, but RFK, I mean, who, these are all scions of the televisual era and celebrities of the televisual era, political celebrities of the televisual era. So I think, I agree with you. Well, but, so I'm less exercised by it now. No one will care.
but isn't that a big part of the whole game, though? I mean, I certainly agree with James that nobody's going to watch this particular ad. Yeah. And in general, it's probably indicative of a certain kind of signaling that maybe doesn't read to Gen Z. But I do think it's telling that, you know, the part of the game of erasing the history of the United States on accusations of racism is that you can then just invoke these specters of tremendous racial trauma so as to heighten the pitch of political discourse to such a fever pitch that people who are looking desperately for some kind of meaning in their lives can situate themselves within a narrative of it's good versus evil, it's the just versus, you know, I mean, like it kind of works to their advantage that nobody knows who George Wallace is, even if this particular piece of content isn't constructed very well.
The voice of whiteness speaks.
Yeah, right, exactly. And like, you know, part of the point of tearing down all of these statues is to just make it all into this sort of inchoate melange of poorly digested and propagandized fragments, these fragments we have shored against our ruins of a forgotten history. Like, I actually think that's part of the whole deal right now.
Mm-hmm. Their newest ad, I should add. For a crew that jumped up and down, hopping mad and incredulous at any suggestion that Hillary Clinton was suffering from health deficiencies in her run, their newest ad is Trump unwell, and they show him walking down the ramp slowly and, you know, mangling talking points, et cetera. It's pretty rich.
It just seems like propaganda that no one asks for because it has the Never Trump angle to it. So it's particularly soulless because it's not clear. It's not clear that it's driven by a real desire for some kind of good.
Yeah.
Right. It's kind of put together by people who are defined by what they're against. And I don't know. I mean, listening to it, I mean, it's hard. I mean, who the absurdity that Trump is somehow a segregationist when, in fact, we know who the segregationists are today. We know who wants to separate people by race using the force of law. And it's actually not Trump. It happens on college campuses, but it's coming soon to neighborhoods and workplaces near you. But my main thought listening to it is I just really want a video of the guy playing the piano, very impassioned in a studio somewhere in Burbank, you know, just hammering this out. And, you know, I think he deserves some props.
I'd also like to know who gets a percentage of that ad buy. there's always somebody making some coin off this.
Oh, yeah.
Thing that I'm curious about is what their end game is, other than the defeat of Trump.
Yeah,
like in the final analysis, what is it that they want? The restoration of some halcyon days where we spent over $1 trillion in the invasion of Iraq. What is it? What is it? Do they want their sinecures back? I don't. I'm trying to come up with an answer that's not cynical, but it's. I can't think of one.
Well, this
just
kind
of the collection of people that comprise the Lincoln Project. Sorry.
Well, this no, I mean, I think that's a really good question. And this sort of toss and turn of free associations, very poorly defined, but just, you know, one thing situated next to another. Here's George Wallace. Now here's Donald Trump speaking in ways that don't bear, you know, if you knew the context of any of those statements, or even if you didn't, you might raise an eyebrow if you were a critical thinker about the extent to which these two things bear comparison with one another. But this is, you know, it's not actually only a televisual enterprise. It's something that is like we're moving more in that direction in the digital age, right? This is part of how digital operates. And James has spoken, I think, very eloquently about this in the past, that it's incredibly hypnotic and it works upon us all, and not just, you know, those of us who are insincere in our motives. So I think that people like the people that made that video are probably not hyper aware of the fact that what they're really doing is they're making televisual media under the influences and auspices of this totally digital habitus that has basically just churned them up too, and just one more of these kind of, you know, they're hypnotized by their own sort of ignorance, essentially. I think they probably believe exactly what they say in that video, but that they are participating in something much, much bigger than them.
Well, it's interesting. And I think, you know, there are many levels on which the incantation that Black Lives Matter work very powerfully, from the literal to the figurative. And we can run through many of them. But for me, and I think in a weird way, this ad, such as it is, drives the point home. The shift from the politics of meaning, which was high Clintonite, emotivist TV era, global sort of peak Western-led globalized American order politics. The shift from that to the politics of mattering seems to me to be very significant. The whole imagination-fueled politics of the pre-digital age has given way to, you know, this is a transitional time, so there's still lots of crazy imagination stuff flying around, but a different problem set. The problem set now is robots are taking over and they're doing more and more of what we do. The mm-hmm. human working class is going away. Deindustrialization is hurtling us into a future where ever more people have ever more time on their hands and ever less of a prospect for doing things that actually have some kind of significance, that provide a sort of representational indication that they do matter in some way. This is a problem that in many ways goes beyond politics. but the two main choices that are being presented to people right now, I think, are on the one hand, well, you know, you can either do something that a computer would do better and function as a kind of peasant, you know, a neo-feudal serf who, you know, well, at least human beings can sort of, you know, smile at each other better than robots can smile at you. You know, a kind of infantilizing, emotional kind of service sector job. Or you can take all of this free time that you have, and obviously coronavirus has contributed to that, and you can plow it into fantasy making and fighting over fantasies and sort of struggling over who controls whose imagination. And while both of those options are very much on the table for many people, and some of them even like it that way, I think that many Americans ultimately reject both of those options. They don't want to be a servant class to a regime run by robots, and they don't want to be sort of foot soldiers in an endless, you know, world war for whoever has the strongest meme power, meme magic. That is a politics of mattering in a sense that I think provides some evidence as to why so many people have taken to the streets in recent weeks, because they want to be physically present for something of consequence. But something, you know, that goes far beyond protests or ideologies. People want to reclaim, I think, a politics that is right-sized to our human being, where ordinary people in ordinary walks of life, in ordinary cities that aren't too big and aren't too small, can actually have a share in self-governance and be relevant and personally significant in the functioning of their part of you know, not the world. The world is like a construct that isn't very persuasive to people anymore. In the corner of their life that extends, you know, probably to their neighborhood, maybe a few towns over, and that's probably about it.
Somewhere in here, I think there has to be, and maybe I'm misreading you, James, but it seems like there has to be a question of, you know, are we going to just posit that the inner life of a human being has a fundamental and irreducible value? I mean, all the stuff that you're talking about, right? Imagine fighting over people's imaginations, their fantasies, wanting to be physically present for something, being able to smile. But I mean, these, you know, we're feeling around at these things that these areas in which we do intuit that we can matter and that we are somehow different than and therefore more important than our machines, and all of it is just kind of, you know, with the, in many ways, you know, between the wars and the after the wars, the rise of subjectivism, this idea, the rise of the idea that you just, like, you know, your feelings are kind of arbitrary and they exist in a sphere apart from the hard data of what's outside you, the objective reality of the world. That's the thing we're up against, right? We're up against reconvincing people that that's not what's going on inside of them, actually.
Isn't that also, I mean, it's really instructive because it points us to the problem. Because I, you know, one of the deeper problem, which from what James was saying, you can see people say, they want to hear someone say, you don't have to live this way. You can build and participate in actual human community,
right?
And you can physically go out and be part of something with your full humanity in the flesh, right? And you hear, and we published a lot of pieces about building. Like, people want to build, you know, I want to build. as our one suit said, you need a god to build. I mean, there's all this stuff about building, and it's all very good, but it's very abstract. The thing about building is you still have to have an understanding of why and what. And the traditional understanding of the human person is that you are able to see what is. The universe is reflected within you. And that connection, right, that mind, what mind used to mean, soul used to mean, reason used to mean.
Yeah.
You are able, in fact, to see what is and reflect the universe within yourself. That then gives you the opportunity to build. Because from that, you see certain things, right, that then you use and you order yourself towards and you order other things in nature towards. That has been overtaken by the imagination or fantasy. That's all gone, right? You can't really know anything. So therefore, you have to create this stuff for yourself. And you're happy to go out and, you know, physically be part of really any kind of community, even if that's rioting, looting and pillaging, right?
No,
or, I mean, or other more you know, kind of boring things, anything really will do.
I think of my two favorite lines maybe from any hymn, which are evermore from his store, new worlds rise up to adore, which kind of gets at this idea that, like, you know, the creation of an individual human person is the creation of an entirely new world. And that is the reality of the world. Everything else is kind of like constructive of that reality.
Yeah. The mind can know all things potentially.
Right.
And therefore it can create these universes and contains the universe within itself and reflects the universe. But these things are all,
Well, and we know that one of the top things in human life for all time to do that gives you a palpable, recognizable experience of mattering is religion, is the building up of religion and the sharing of religious observance. And what you're seeing on the illiberal left now is the building of a religion.
Right.
These failing institutions of a dying age, whether it's media or academia as we know it today, you know, all the sort of marquee modern institutions, entertainment, Hollywood, even, you know, Wall Street, these institutions are being turned into religious schools. This is the kind of thing that people who have tons of time on their hands because robots have taken away all the jobs will do. They will sit around and create complex doctrines of ritual and religious faith and pronunciation and fill their time that way. It'll happen on the right. It'll happen on the left. It'll probably happen in ways that continue in some respects to blur the categories of right and left that we got accustomed to in modernity, and which that, you know, now famous little four square graph plotting the Trump voters and the Clinton voters with, you know, the underserved quadrant of, you know, economically quote unquote left and culturally quote unquote right people. That'll continue, and I think it'll become stronger regardless of who wins in November.
Speaking of robots, we wanted to bring up Google and this latest kerfuffle.
Is it a contretemps? Is that Spencer? Is that, you speak foreign languages. Is that
sure. It's all of the above.
Yeah. Yeah. So Google, it was reported by NBC News that Google had demonetized the Federalist and Zero Hedge. It turns out that it wasn't quite true of the Federalist. They had been given a window. And the rationale, at least for the Federalist, as I understand it, was that the ads that were running alongside their comment section were alongside comments that were, you know, extreme and racist, et cetera, et cetera. Google, of course, as Google does, messed with some of the wrong people, probably half unwittingly, at least. I know Ben is Dominich, the publisher of the Federalist, is quite well connected in Washington and quickly was on the phone with quite a few lawmakers who were interested in this topic because they're having hearings about Section 230 and Google and everything else. So our friend Max Pappas, who runs outreach and relations, I forget his exact title, in Washington, D.C. for Google, of course, he talked to me back when we had this problem with retargeting ads and a piece we wrote on multiculturalism prohibiting us from advertising our annual gala last spring. If you want to check that out, go to americanmind.org and look up algorithms of suppression. You could just Google algorithms of suppression, Claremont, and it'll pop right up. You know, this is a thing that happens. And if you're Ben Dominich or you're the Claremont Institute and you complain online, we have networks of friends who are pretty plugged in Washington. And the problem, you know, gets fixed pretty quickly. It's said to be a mistake. I think part of what Google said is that as long as they took down the comments section, it wasn't a problem. We'll see how this continues to develop. It's pretty rich in a way to complain about comment threads because last time I checked, Google owns YouTube. And the YouTube comment section is like the most depraved place on the planet or close to it. I mean, 4chan's a little worse in parts, but yeah. So anyway, I think this is a problem that won't go away for Google. I think it's going to just pique the interest of the senators and House members who are looking at this problem, Nunes, Hawley, Cruz, et cetera. And, you know, this question of our access to online platforms is one that's just revving up.
It is revving up, and it's it's with good reason. You know, we talk about algorithms of suppression, or there are also now, functionally speaking, algorithms of radicalization, of mobilization. It's, you know, based on what I've been seeing on social media, which I partake of less and less. I will admit, is. A growing sense that whether intentionally or not, the platforms are beginning to act as a sort of election before the election, where, you know, you get the multitudes together, you meme them as hard as you can. And in effect, the election where people actually have to cast a vote is kind of an emotional afterthought that merely formalizes what has already been established online. Online, of course, which is in some ways the least best suited place for either individuals or groups to deliberate about anything. Things move so quickly that you are either freed of the burden or the luxury of deliberation, depending on how you see that task. And so as we approach November, one of the things that I will be looking at, you know, hiding my eyes to some degree, is how explicit certain figures in politics and media get in recasting the major platforms as the true and authoritative and legitimate source of public opinion as sort of a de facto vote. I think that we're getting there faster than I would have thought. But I think that, you know, as the question of, you know, how we matter resurfaces, one of the sub questions of that is, you know, what is what is the character of democracy going to be in a way that chimes harmoniously with this milieu that we're in? And I think there's going to be a lot of pressure, you know, coming from the same folks. And people forget, you know, when Obama was reelected, hosannas were sung to the power of technology to micro-target audiences and to deliver ads to specific constituencies.
Drive turnout,
mm-hmm. you know, all the things that Cambridge Analytica honestly sucked at doing and were rank amateurs compared to the Obama team. That was all considered to be, you know, how big data will save politics. People were really, really.
I like to point out, he was the first Twitter president. They called him the Twitter president. And that was really awesome that he was on Twitter.
And they were scandalized that things went the other way in 2016. And now, you know, they have incentives and visions that go far beyond any one person, including Donald Trump, that lead them to conclude that they need to grab control of the online public square and never let it go again.
It's funny. I have, and I say this without a tinge of irony, I have the great pleasure and good fortune of copy editing a manuscript right now that Ryan asked me to copy edit about the progressives, right? About mm-hmm. the progressive movement in America, and you know, especially Woodrow Wilson and Teddy Roosevelt. And
R.J. Pistrito's manuscript.
I wasn't sure if I was allowed to say that. Okay.
In the distant future from Encounter Books, so keep an eye out for it. We'll tell you then too.
Yeah, really valuable, worthwhile book. I'm thoroughly enjoying reading it as I copy edit it, and there are very few typos, I may say. but no, I mean, of course, much of his focus is on the birth of the administrative state and this idea among progressives that basically, you know, now that the public, the popular opinion is so united, all you have to do is basically get their input on the general direction that America is going to go. And then you will just have competent bureaucrats to minutely orchestrate every part of it. And even if the public doesn't even really know quite what it wants, the competent bureaucrats will be so enlightened that they'll be able to discern precisely what that is. And in some ways, it seems to me that what we are witnessing is the apotheosis of that philosophy in big tech, that, you know, for the idea that big tech could save democracy is predicated on exactly that idea, that if you just have enough access to data and enough ability to kind of, in this, you know, whatever that computer is, an X-Men, you know, if you have that ability to kind of look into all the data in the world and then organize it with this galaxy brain approach, then you will be able to solve everything. It's remarkable and ironic to me that given all the talk about systemic and invisible influence over us right now in the form of racism, all the systemic racism, you can't see or prove racism, but it's, you know, destroying your life from the inside out. Nobody seems to even stop and think that perhaps, you know, hashtag the real systemic bias or whatever is this massive, basically, you know, administrative state 2.0 in big tech.
Yeah, only if we treat you like machines will you be saved.
Yeah.
What a sales pitch. Yeah. What a sales pitch.
Well, that's when that's when social science will finally be wonderfully valid and predictive, right? When we're when we actually operate like machines, or machines get sophisticated enough to measure us as much as we measure things in the natural sciences. All right. Well, we wanted to take up this issue of political authority, political parties, political power in the West right now. We're in this odd rolling populist moment and an equally an opposite reaction of the elites across the West at large. And Matt had a good little take on this, and I've got a little follow-up riff too. So take it away, Dr. Peterson.
Well, I think a lot of people are trying to figure out what is happening. What is Black Lives Matter? What is it? What's going on right now in relation to this movement? And we could call it a kind of Antifa Black Lives Matter coalition. If you're listening and you're on the left, even you shouldn't take alarm. I mean, whatever that coalition is that is driving people into the streets, and all the people who are driven into the streets who are protesting, and all the people who support them. What's driving this? What manner of thing is this? And, you know, Tucker had some interesting remarks the other night saying, well, whatever it is, they clearly have real power because they get results. They get money. And I would just like people to start rethinking about American politics and the political parties in these terms. The real political parties in America aren't really the Democrats and Republicans. Those are really vehicles for kind of, you know, performing on the stage and vehicles for legal reasons, tradition. It's a vehicle for something else. And what are the real parties right now? Same goes for the right. Everything I'm saying applies to the right as well. The real political parties are whatever that Antifa BLM coalition is and the MAGA coalition that actually gets flesh and blood bodies to pick up from the last section into the streets. That's politics. That's real politics. And that's real power. That's also, by the way, when violence occurs because you have people in the streets, that's also, by the way, a sign that a democracy or republic is in decline or in a very dangerous, dangerous place. That is Weimarish. There's no way around it. So I guess the way to start thinking about this is that the Democratic Party and the Republican Party don't really seem to be in charge of these coalitions, but they must bow down to them nonetheless, right? We know that Nancy Pelosi and friends putting on the African dress, right, and taking the knee, we know they don't they're not really part of this movement, right? They're bowing down to it. That's what the act suggests. But nonetheless, they are bowing down to something outside themselves. And similarly, in Washington, when it comes to Republicans, the same thing is happening, whether Republican voters get it or not. These old school institutions, they've bowed down to MAGA or given it lip service, but are they really part of that coalition? No. So increasingly, there's a third party that becomes more manifest by the day, because it becomes more desperate by the day, as we see with the left recently, with in the last few weeks. There is a third party that's actually in control of our institutions, and that party is desperate and is doing whatever it can to pander to the actual functional parties that exist in the United States of America right now. And you know, I mean, people would have said I was crazy for saying this 2 years ago. There are probably people who think this is still kind of out there now. But I think in the next, you know, in the next few years, this will just become common knowledge, because we are in the middle of a massive realignment that is only begun.
The real third party, Matt, that you're talking about are the one that's desperate and genuflecting. You mean what, the sort of permanent bureaucracy and managerial class, professional class?
Yeah. So the permanent class that is actually in charge of the institutions has to give lip service to the base. But yeah, the base is not the old base.
And they do it mostly through one of the parties, mostly the Democratic Party, but it's a sort of thing apart.
Yes.
Yeah. And I forget who brought it up on, I think it was on Twitter, sometimes it was insightful, that, and you know, we've all thought of this, and I think we even talked about this weeks and weeks, and if not months ago. But you know, it's interesting that the populist revolts across the Western world, even in a parliamentary system like Britain, you know, Brexit still hasn't happened, you know, the sort of British version of BLM Antifa is trying very hard to bring down, if not functionally, at least practically for the time being, Boris Johnson's government, and you know, tie them up in trying to protect statues and not be racist, et cetera, et cetera. But you have, the real ruling class in both Britain, both the UK and the United States, seems to be certainly without question to be some weird mix of the bureaucrats, the credentialed class who floats in and around government, more or less permanent government, the intelligence community, et cetera. And that really, they seem to be, you know, close to unassailable. They may suffer short-term setbacks, but they consolidate and they hit back pretty effectively.
Don't you think BLM is a good example in this? Because they do just shoot their money to Joe Biden. I mean, ultimately, they are colonized.
What's funneling through Act Blue, and
yes,
and yeah, the Dems are taking a cut. Yeah.
Yeah. So ultimately, all the money they get and the cut they get is going to the establishment leader of Democrats. So this is all they are themselves colonized by the establishment. But I think there is a problem for the establishment on both sides, because Antifa and BLM means business, and they have an entire generation of kids who mean business as well. And you saw this with Bernie, and you see it now again. They can keep playing this game, but eventually that is going to bite them in the, you know what, because these people will not care once they actually take power, and they're feeling their power. What just happened really was a demonstration of the most fundamental political power that you can exercise in any regime. And that is, you are afraid of me and you will do what I say because I can flex in public and I can get away with it.
Yeah.
And in a way, this happened on the right when Trump won. And the establishment kind of the same reaction, like, well, okay, well, we'll go along with this, et cetera. But that's the dynamic. And on both sides, I mean, my own opinion on this is obviously, it has been for a while, this is not going to last. I mean, eventually this is going to crack, but your establishment on both sides is just in complete denial and they think they can manage it. The left has a better case. Like, maybe the establishment left can actually manage it. But now you're at the point where you're lighting something on fire, right? Literally. Mm-hmm. And you're demonstrating that you're able to get people in the streets and commit violence, and you're okay with that. And I guess I put it this way. The money is still going to Joe Biden through Act Blue, when it's given to to BLM and all these gifts to, you know, minority groups, where really they're all being channeled through the party to the establishment. At the same time, when you look at the picture of Nancy Pelosi kneeling with her, you know, her African garb.
Kente cloth.
Yeah, her kente cloth.
Of the Ashanti tribe.
Yeah. Yeah. When you look at that, you think she's not actually in charge.
If there were such a thing as an academy in America or the West more generally, this would, I mean, maybe my fellow classicists are out there listening somewhere, you know, this would be an amazing moment to write a book about the office of the Tribune of the Plebs, right? It's not for me to do because I'm not a Romanist, I'm not a Latinist, but some enterprising Latin, right? I mean, this notion.
Maybe our friend Barry Strauss.
I was just thinking Spencer, of him, actually. Yeah.
Go listen to Young Heretics. Spencer just interviewed Barry Strauss on the 10 Caesars and other cool stuff.
Yeah, right. And he was magnificent. I mean, Barry, thanks for that plug, Ryan.
Yeah, sure.
Much appreciated. He was magnificent, and he would be the guy to do this, really. The notion that there exists a political office for people who basically translate the, you know, wall of popular opinion, this kind of advancing mob of just, you know, raw anger, and translates that into both a kind of symbolic office, a representative office, and mm-hmm. also into structural reforms. That's basically where we're at. And people may recall that Gaius and Tiberius Gracchus, famous tribune of the pleb, the Gracchi brothers, are often heralded as kind of harbingers of the end of the republic. And that is, you know, we are in kind of late stage republic.
Yeah.
Stuff right now.
And they think that this will lead to their power. I mean, this is what's so disheartening and so dark about the time we live in. You have elites who really think that and don't care about the violence, the fear that they're inciting. I mean, what are they doing? They're inciting fear. I mean, they're inciting the lot. What they've done for years is establish the narrative that if you are black, you need to be worried about being gunned down every time you interact with the police. Now, you know, you're more likely to be pulled over. That's true. But the idea that police are gunning black people down in large numbers is the lie they've promulgated. They don't care at all about the consequences of that. The shameless demagoguery that's gone on, right? They will just march black bodies into the streets and use them for elite purposes all they want. And they think that'll be fine. And if there are negative consequences, they don't care. I mean, they don't care at all, because the pressure on the left, it's really the real story, I think, is since 2008, 2009, all the woke stuff has gone, you know, crazy, whether it's their language or their talk and their views among wealthy white liberals, because they know that there is a class war that could break out at any time that's already begun. And so they need to make this racial. They need to make this racial. So the pressure is to keep everyone on the reservation, because for somehow, you know, Republicans, even though they haven't been in charge of your city for 70 years.
Watch your phrasing, Matt.
Are going to.
Reservation.
You're canceled. I'm sorry. That's the end.
I meant it in the negative term that people use. I meant it in the term, in the way that the most woke left means it. That is what they're doing. And they have to push on identity politics, because what you're in danger of if you're on the left is the ruse being up, is actual class warfare breaking out, in which case you're screwed because you own all the institutions and you've brought the wealthy over to your side. That was actually one of the major thrusts of Tucker's book, Ship of Fools was the left became the party of the wealthy, and that was a real thing. So I mean the shamelessness of it and the is astounding, and the darkness of our time is that these people do not care. They don't care about promoting this kind of violence or division at all. They think they're going to hang on in the late republic, and they're going to hang on to their power this way. And the problem is, of course, that they're not going to be able to do that. It's inevitable that they fail.
As easy as it is to make fun of the autonomous zone in Seattle, yes. This is at least a group of people who are attempting on some level, however Ballardian it may appear, to make a go of it.
Yeah.
To autonomously focus their energies not on the world, some abstract entity that needs to be fixed or healed or saved or unified or whatever, you know, choose your own sort of trope. not even on the country, such as it is, but six square blocks. And maybe they want more than six square blocks. Maybe they do. Maybe they don't. Maybe it depends. But what I think you've seen on the left specifically, because for a couple of different reasons, the right is more reluctant to go down this road, but it may have to do so as well in its own way. Is an attempt to respond to the fundamental challenge to ideology by identity with an effort to fold identity into an all-encompassing ideology, right? Identity politics. Don't forget politics, guys. Don't just appreciate identity so much that you start to give up on the most ridiculous and abstract and totalizing claims upon you of our form of politics so that identity is great so long as we ideologues are in control of the mix of identities, who, you know, of determining what portion is due to what constituency, you know, how many seats on the boards of directors should be this particular ethnicity or that particular race. This is kind of the scam of multiculturalism, right? Is that it's not a multicultural society. It is a society that is multicultural where there's an overarching ideology that's controlled by a specific and unchanging elite, right?
Yep.
What seems like we're facing is a scenario in the West, and I think in the US, where and we already know that many people tell pollsters that they're sick and tired of politics and they're exhausted of politics, and they're going to start giving up on the idea that, you know, there's some kind of overarching figure who can come in, whether it's a Joe Biden or a Mitt Romney or whoever the hell, and heal the nation's wounds.
These very powerful figures.
Bring us like all together.
Mitt Romney and Joe
the
Biden.
Power of politics. People are going to say, you know what? Just give me my identity. Give me my like kind, and let me be a member in good standing of my like kind, and just let us make a go of it. We don't need overarching politics. We don't need ideological contestation. We just need our corner of the world, and let us be who we are.
I'm not sure that that's the totality of what's going on in Chaz, right? Because it's there's a lot of different kinds of, you know, people in
they're China. Communists and anarchists.
Excuse me, it's CHOP now. It's the CHOP, Capitol Hill right. Occupied Protest,
yes,
right, or something
yes.
like that.
Yeah. The Nation of CHOP. but I do think that what James is describing certainly is the urge that I think people on all sides of the spectrum have. And that's why I think when it comes to CHOP, a lot of people on the right too think it's hilarious. My own take is, you know, if it was just a bunch of right-leaning, you know, radical right-leaning people, they would all be shot and killed by now, which is why the right doesn't do this. But I do think that the people admire this because they feel the need to just cut off from the whole thing, like you're saying, and just go, yeah, let me live my identity. Like, we'll go to like, right? We'll all have the same views and we'll just build something then, because you do need some kind of sameness in order to create a society, and let me find whatever that is and let me go do it.
Well, that use of the word politics, right, that James and you are both now using, it suggests that the very idea, you know, you sort of imagine, and that you can tell, I think, from the rhetoric.
So for us to be unified, we need some kind of unity.
Yeah, right. Exactly. I mean, from the language that's coming out of the CHOP and the Chaz, you can tell that they think you can abstract yourself out of politics, that you can leave politics as so understood outside the door, because they're sick and tired and fed up with the kind of hem-hawing and the bureaucracy and the congressional gridlock and all of this stuff. And what they want is just this utopia that is like free and abstracted from that. The reason that they think that that's possible is because like everybody has lost the Aristotelian notion of politics. Everybody has lost the idea that politics just is the word for the structures that we create when we live together, and that living together just fundamentally is something that we do. And so all of our amusement at the whole thing is just watching them, you know, think that they can do that. And then whoops, like the end of our adventures is to arrive back at our beginnings, you know, like here they are in a warlord autocracy. I mean, but at least they have some, you know, fundamental.
Yeah, so they, learning the lesson you should learn freshman year of high school.
They forgot that justice is hard.
Right.
I'm so tempted. I mean, you know, I'd like the dinner salad. What are your options, sir? We have the chop or the jazz. I wanted to zoom out a little bit and just, first of all, I think David Barr wanted to jump in.
Matt, I was curious if you or anybody thought the protests and ensuing riots would have occurred in the absence of the COVID lockdown and just the economic pain that everyone is feeling.
I don't think they would have occurred to the level anywhere near the level they did without the lockdown at all. I go completely like very strong. I mean, yeah. The reason they happened is because these videos come out every year, right? I'm not the only one to point this out. This effort has been ongoing for a long time. And what no one is talking about is the fact that the psychological and economic effects of the virus restrictions prepared and the tinder, right? It was dry. It was ready this time to burn. And that's absolutely a part of this. And let me go further. I think
Matt, does that mean that the movement is less strong than we are giving it credit for?
In a way, yes. In a way, no. I mean, in one way, yeah, the reason you actually got action on the streets is because you had a lot of people who are not ideological who were ready to be moved by ideology. Right. So the ideologues are with
or
us.
They just want to get out of the house.
Yeah, exactly. That's what I mean. Exactly. Well, so right. Exactly.
Come see, come saw.
The ideologues are already there trying to push everyone. And all of a sudden you have a situation in which people are much more willing to be pushed because, yeah, I got to get out of the house. And why don't I get mine? On the other hand, in a way, no, the justification for this kind of behavior is baked into the cake already for every, you know, millennial and under. I mean, they already know why it's okay to do these things. It's okay to loot because of their history and all the rest. So when it comes to the virus, I mean, there's no way you would have had this to the extent you did, but now you have this polished weapon and I kind of like all the necessary conditions were there and the virus is the thing that put it over the top.
Yeah, but now I think you might be right, David, about the extent to which it exacerbated the building of it in the beginning. But now it's a sort of perpetual motion machine of sorts, and we'll continue through November, I think, in some fashion. I wanted to end just the segment on this. That doesn't mean you all can't comment on what I'm about to say. But if we zoom out a little bit, you know, we open discussion with the West and populism and the permanent state. So this is actually – this whole thing is new, though, in that context because – with Russiagate, with impeachment, with anti-Brexit, it was very much an elite phenomenon revolting against a populist leader. They were in the driver's seat, and Matt, you're kind of alluding to this. So, but this thing is new because it's this street movement. Look, there's probably plenty of grass tops stoking of it. You know, nothing happens for no good reason, as our old IR professor friend Bill Rude used to say here in Claremont. You know, these things are always coordinated to a certain extent and they're ops to a certain extent, especially in the last sort of 40 years. But this is new. You know, it was a genuine kind of street movement in a sense that then was seized by the ruling classes, both in the UK and in the US to use it for their ends. And I will disagree with you just a little bit, Matt. I do think the Democratic Party will be able to harness this and ride it. It may eventually come out of their control. But look, if you control the federal government, you can give out a lot of money to all your constituent groups. And it's already happening at the state level. I mean, the part of – I had Chris Rufo, who is an old Lincoln fellow of ours, we were talking on our weekly call with donors last night, and Chris made the point. He's been writing at City Journal. He lives near Seattle. Tried to run for city council there, and Antifa made his life miserable, and he dropped out. But his point was that, you know, Chaz is going to end in one of two ways. They have said if there's a structure fire or an active shooter that they'll go in, mm-hmm. and I suspect they'll break it all up at that point. But the other way is just to buy them off, to funnel a bunch of money into all these community organizing groups. It might kind of half break up and half not. I mean, this, you know, one of our commenters last night said People's Park in Berkeley was occupied for 40 years. So, you know, this
okay.
is...
Okay. I don't think it's the same thing.
No. That's public yeah. property, and this is actually has businesses and residences in it. But yeah, it's
how large was the Occupy Wall Street enclave? Is it just a little park? Or I don't know New York well.
It wasn't huge, right? I don't remember.
Spicoli Park or whatever.
That was a park. That was a park, though.
Yeah.
I mean, I would say, I mean, okay, it's true that you can buy off your constituency. I think the difference is, the dynamics are the same as Tom Wolfe writing about what happened, on the West Coast or New York at Bernstein's party in the 70s, right?
Yeah.
But the
radical chic and Mau Mauing the flat catchers.
Yeah, Mau Mauing the flat catchers. Great. It explains this dynamic. If you don't know what we're talking about, you should look up Tom Wolfe's essay. It just explains the dynamic between kind of black radicals and white wealthy liberals. And that's been going on for a long time. But I think the difference is that as you get to in the late Republic, the hours in the late Republic lengthen, it becomes harder and harder to buy people off. And eventually what you're seeing now is a kind of movement you couldn't even imagine in the 60s and 70s, actually. You could see organic anger then, but now you see a PhD driven, which is what Black Lives Matter is. It's a PhD, critical studies kind of driven movement that is absolutely coming straight out of elite society, and its ideology has no limiting principle. And what it will, if left to its own devices, eventually do is just eat up the left itself. And so, we'll see. They certainly think that they can control it now or that it's good to placate it. And you're right. That could go on for a long time. It has for hundreds of years in some societies. But I think they're playing with fire literally at this point. And I can't see them. I can't see it lasting. Those radicals will take over. And you see it in these riots. And one more thing, I'll shut up. But you see it in these riots physically, right? Geographically. We're not rioting in ghettos, right? Which I agree with. That's a smart play. I'm going to go to Rodeo Drive. And the next step is for me to go to the houses in Beverly Hills. Now, the cops in Beverly Hills will probably kill me if I do that because they'll defend these white, wealthy liberal areas. Mm-hmm. But that's now the level we're at. And you did not see, right? But privately, you hear and see all kinds of different things. Publicly, the face of it is the same. Oh, no, this was an acceptable loss. That's fine. We're going to keep the masses at bay and they're going to be fine. And we're going to pay them off.
And they were mostly peaceful protests, too.
Yes. How long you can keep that up, I don't know. We'll see. Yeah.
And is it enough to say, hey, we'll just give everyone a UBI? You know, Annie Lowrey's book, Give People Money, was like the most recent sort of book-length statement, I think, on the wisdom and virtue of the UBI. And I know that things are a little bit different.
Because I mean, I guess you can buy more than bread and circuses if they just get money directly.
Well, but is it enough? I mean, is it enough when you just kind of are kept in this state of suspended animation, you know, whatever your relative comfort level. People get bored. And especially when they can clearly perceive that the world that that they grew up in is collapsing, is passing away. You know, I mean, we can maybe talk about the demise of the Cecil Rhodes statue, Spencer.
If you want me to like have to that's the inject next, myself next string letters. Yeah, exactly.
Well, you know, when I think of Cecil Rhodes, of course, I think of the famous cartoon. It wasn't really that cartoonish, but you know, the characterization of Rhodes, you know, from Cape to Cairo, sort of one boot on one end of Africa. Right. And another boot on the other. And the important thing that people don't remember about that image is that, you know, he was not holding a sword. He was not even holding a Maxim gun.
Yep.
Whatever happens, we have got the Maxim gun and they have not, as the old saying went. He was holding the telegraph. He was holding the telegraph wire. And the whole point of Cape to Cairo was Cecil Rhodes wanted to string the telegraph from one end of the British Empire in Africa to the other. It was a civilizing force of progress and technology. And the reality is we have entered into a time when the telegraph no longer says anything good or exciting to ordinary people. They do not see this sort of legacy electric technology as a gift, as a sign of world togetherness, as much of anything.
He's defending Cecil Rhodes.
What
I'm also triggered. Also canceled.
Rather than defending Cecil Rhodes, I'm suggesting that the deep-seated desire to remove statues of people of a bygone technological age is perhaps rooted in something gasp even more powerful than racial animus or racial guilt or anarchist or any other ideological sort of affiliation.
I don't know.
James. This is James, very understandable. James's ancestor, Alcibiades, went around.
great.
Wait a minute. How many children did Alcibiades have? I guess he did have some.
That's pretty good. I just wanted to close with this point. I think the big tell of the permanent state's willingness to bow to the mob. We all saw, of course, the official left, that is, as Matt mentioned, the Kente cloth-wearing Democrats kneeling to the mob. But the this whole group of people in the permanent bureaucracy, the intelligence community and elsewhere, and their media allies were preaching at us for 3 months that we had to stay indoors. We had to save lives. Yeah. We had to do all this. And then as soon as this lefty movement was on the streets and could be harnessed, 1,200 health professionals write a letter saying, actually, it's not a threat to public health to be all outside in large numbers yelling. And all of a sudden, this is a point that's been made over and over that everyone's probably sick of. And it's trite at this point. But the speed with which that switched, and now they're going to try to switch it back as they're ginning up scares about, spiking cases in Arizona and Texas. It's one thing that's going to come out of this, and maybe it's a silver lining, is the people's faith. The people writ large's faith in quote unquote government experts, I think, is dwindling even further as they see this cynical ploy.
I mean, I think you're right to bring that up again. And remember what they said in the letter. It wasn't just, it's okay to protest for this reason as opposed to this reason. They actually said these protests are fine. Tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands of people in the streets, it's fine. It's all good. No one's going to kill their grandma like you are. If 180-year-old guy who prayed in front of a Planned Parenthood in San Francisco for 10 years,
right,
and they arrested him. And if Harmy Dillon hadn't got him off the hook, they would have prosecuted him with criminal charges. Some old 80-year-old guy praying on the sidewalk. That's bad. These people are fine, and we're not going to prosecute them. So you got all that. But in that letter, they also said, but if you protest the virus restrictions,
yeah, that's bad.
You're racist. Yeah, that's right.
And really, this will be a nice lead into our next segment. And impious, right? Because if you're out in favor of the state religion, that's fine. If you're in favor of old timey religion, can't have that. Well, some people may think my invocation of piety and impiety was a bit over the top, but no, gentle listener, I have solid proof, as it was reported today that there are now baptisms going on at the site of George Floyd's killing, and he's been made a saint. I don't know who the hell made him a saint or what this means really, but there's video of a decidedly religious event quality going on. But it's, it's typical New Age leftism religion. There's a band and everyone's sort of dancing around, but that there's also, black ladies holding white women and saying incantations and vice versa. It's all very, very odd. So we just wanted to talk a bit in this last segment about not only that, but the continuing madness of this ongoing statue destroying business. I just wanted to put in one good word for the French. or Macron in particular. So while Britain cowers and has some of their statues torn down and it's boxed up Churchill in this gray, you know, if it was an obelisk, it would have been slightly more dignified, but it's just a giant rectangle stretching into the sky, covering him up so that he doesn't get defaced again. And even talk of moving Churchill to a museum, which I think would be the true and final death knell of any semblance of greatness in the British. Macron, through all this, you know, he gave this speech the other night where he said, look, we have to deal with anti-Semitism and racism, of course, and, you know, we won't let these things we're implacable foes of these things, but we will, and he kind of got animated and passionate at this point. He said, but we will not tear down any of our statues. Our history is important. You know, we can't forget any of this, you know, especially our history with Africa in all of its problems. You know, he really took a stand for Frenchness and for French history and for French civilization. I mean, with his disclaimers and caveats that he, of course, has to do leading a centrist of sorts party in France. But, you know, who would have thought that the most spine in the West on this question of our heritage, our history, and our statues, you know, Trump has talked a good game over the last 3 years, but he hasn't seemed to have done much of late. Or said much more of late. Maybe we'll expect more, but yeah, two cheers for Macron.
Well, the French have experience with the erasure of history, and they know that it doesn't go particularly well. Yeah. I mean, I did think as he was speaking, as Macron was speaking of the 10-day week, you know, which is kind of the ultimate attempt to reconfigure in the kind of late French Revolution, the attempt to reconfigure both the world and history according to your own idea of capital R reason, which you might replace with capital S science in our present day. Just, you know, the what James was saying earlier about the search for meaning and mattering kind of peaking in this movement of just genuinely canonizing George Floyd, a person whose actual life and actual struggles and suffering are completely unrelated to what's going on. I mean, I don't know if you've seen the New Yorker's latest cover, but it's just Floyd's head, and then his body is made up of all the different civil rights struggles of the country, from that famous image of a slave bearing the lacerations, the physical lacerations of whipping, leading up to Trayvon Martin. And I mean, that's kind of, you know, that aggregated into this one person are all of these many different struggles, you know, and it's, again, goes right back to what we were talking about in the first segment, that some of those struggles are genuine racial trauma and genuine regime crisis in the history of this nation. And then those are just neatly elided in this image into basically confected problems. Not that there aren't lingering issues to do with the history of race in this country, but that essentially we are dealing now with a highly artificial, but also religious and spiritualized idea about progress and where the country is going. I think it's all just a little bit on the nose, really, is the problem. It's just kind of too explicit, except that if you're in it, I'm sure it seems quite logical because it does have a certain degree of logic to it, and it's kind of internal logic.
It is difficult to live well in any time for most people in the absence of any kind of religious sensibility.
Right.
You know, if the philosophers down through the ages have a slightly different claim to make, but I think, you know, there are what, like maybe about 1500 philosophers ever, like even in these PhD inflated times, right. You know, I'm not counting all those people, but genuine philosophers are very few. What I want to say about the statues is, you know, the French are an interesting case, and the British are an interesting case as well. Churchill, for all of his at times, I think, justifiably brutal sense of realism and unwillingness to shy away from the undeniable, he was quite romantic about what he called the English-speaking peoples, mm-hmm. Which, of course, at that time meant the Americans and the British, and, you know, the constituent members of the British Empire and the Commonwealth. which already at that point, you know, by the end of the Second World War, the English speaking peoples were a globalized cosmopolitan hodgepodge of loosely aligned, generally democratic, generally liberal, and generally literate people, most of whom were relatively well-rooted in spite of their cosmopolitan spirit, well-rooted members of venerable civilizations of some form or another, people who had a clear understanding of the relationship between past, present, and future and of how their identities sort of fit into the mix. Today, we have a slightly different configuration. We have, you know, the internet, which made everyone in the world a member of the English-speaking peoples and sort of vaporized the last vestiges of that kind of Anglo-American post-British imperial hope of a community of nations, a united nations, led, of course, by the English-speaking peoples in the form of the U.S. and the U.K., basically Five Eyes, but like a competent version that actually was able to foresee problems before they arose.
Five Eyes, but good.
Five Eyes, but good. If any part of the Churchillian dream seems to me to be deceased, torn down like a veritable statue, it is this dream—the dream of the English-speaking peoples leading the globe into the sunny uplands of the post-war world, whether post Great War, World War II, Cold War. The idea was that the cousins across the Atlantic would ultimately prevail through their gentility and their wit and their magnanimity, and their broad-mindedness in the gentlemanly sense. Their industriousness, all those kinds of Anglo-American virtues, from Cairo to Cape Town, if you will, including the Indian subcontinent and all the territories upon which the sun never famously set. That seems to me to be gone, and I think the shock of just how gone it is has not quite sunken in. There was the initial wave of decolonization, which the U.S. supported against the British. If you want to know more about that, just read about the debacle of the Suez Canal incident in, I think, 1956, that was.
Sounds right to me.
But we are now, we're now at a point where even many Brits themselves are sort of, their past is irrelevant to their everyday lives. That goes all the more so for various other peoples scattered around the world, just kind of reeling from what was supposed to have been this triumphal moment of, Anglo-American liberalism being institutionalized around the world and has now turned into very much not that.
You're making me think about something which will now be a very half-baked theory that I float here live. We're doing it live.
We thrive on half-baked.
Yeah. We thrive on live.
I know. I feel like this is a safe space for me to float this half-baked.
Did you say half-baked? That's more than quarter-baked. Usual around
That's
here.
Right. Yeah. This is just dough. It's just a lump of dough. But I wonder, you're making me think about the notion of a common language, the idea that what would unite a transnational people would be not some set of creeds or ideas or even some kind of apotheosized version of the state or what have you, but a language. And
Esperanto, as George Soros.
Right. And not Esperanto, right? Not a made up language, right, but an existing language that was then shared and exported to the world. And there is precedent, there is ancient precedent for this inherent to us in the word barbarism. The Greeks already believed that those who spoke Greek were in some way inherently more civilized than those who did not. And whatever prejudice may have been baked into that attitude, it was at least a prejudice that could be overcome by learning to speak Greek. And there is evidence of, the Greek-speaking world being akin in many ways to what James is describing with the English-speaking world.
The Hellenistic world.
The Hellenistic, right,
the Latin world, and these things have happened.
And of course, the lingua franca, right? I mean, the kind of the irony of lingua franca being a Latin phrase describing this idea about French, that And I think then further back yet again to the story of Babel, the Tower of Babel, that the mankind wished to be united in one, and what God did in order to prevent that kind of what would have in fact been a quite hideous apotheosis on the part of mankind was to separate us all into separate languages, separate ways, not only of talking about the world, but even of conceiving the world and separating it up into concepts. It happens that in Isaiah, I only know about this because it's Isaiah, you know, it happens that in Isaiah, when he envisages all of the peoples of the world streaming back into Zion at the behest of the Messiah, when we are all saved.
Like in the Matrix?
Like a little bit like in the Matrix, right? Like rivers of water.
Zion. That better dancing.
By the rivers of, like that Sublime Zion? Song?
Yeah, right.
Which was a cover.
Which is a cover of a
No, they made that song up.
A golden oldie, an oldie but goodie. But, you know, he uses to describe that the word the name the place name Shinar, which is the name that that Babel had before it was Babel, so that kind of going back to this pre-Babel
going back
moment,
to the unity.
Right? Exactly this idea, and it is both a transcendent vision and also in some sense an unachievable one that you would share with the world your language, which is somewhere in between sharing with the world your vision of it and sharing with the world just your pure race. It's some middle of that, middle ground of this kind of heritage that is also has folded into it and baked into it this whole way of looking at the world. That's all I have to say.
No, that's pretty good.
That's my quarter baked.
They're found. I have very brief thoughts to tack on, but first, a totally lame question. Has anyone seen that movie, Babel, like that won the awards? I refuse to watch it.
Because
it.
Is that a Brad Pitt vehicle of some kind?
Yeah.
The one that the preview starts with him in a bus. Looks so pretentious and insufferable. I just refused.
As you see, so no one here saw it?
I don't think anyone.
I saw 21 Grams in the movie theater, so I felt that I was exempt.
Did that win the award?
Best picture? I don't know.
Well, note, by the way, also, because of this.
I was the same way, though. I saw the previews like,
Right.
Jake can look it up first.
A footnote to the rant that I've just gone on is that note the identity between Babel and Babylon, which is where Jerusalem goes into exile. Is the place of the confounding of language is the place of all hope.
And I feel like that's the darkness of our time is that we're in a time when this fracturing is happening all over. And so it's very difficult to make any kind of argument, and you can see the eagerness with which we are fracturing, and the statues, breaking statues is part of that. And
the fact that we have this common language on a level that we never had, no sooner do we get global English than we frantically create these impenetrable language sublanguages of terminological weirdness for us.
It's a reflex in a way that's a terrible thing. The only thing I can think to stop myself from ranting for a long time is my grandmother taught me, although she never said it explicitly, that if you have something negative to say about someone, you should use profanity. and so I can't do that. But when it comes to the statues, what's amazing to me is the kind of, there's a way in which you can say human lives are really important, our buildings important, right? As BLM says, and everyone else says, buildings can't be important. Physical things can't be important, right? The imagination is important. The ideas we have about people are important. But what's amazing to me is how we're just watching this happen. I mean, random like images, right, of people who have really nothing to do with what's going on right now. And the Sutter, John Sutter, Sutter's Mill in California, getting rid of poor John Sutter, who was really just this schmo who, you know, had a decent little thing going, and then gold was discovered on his property and it ruined his life, and he never became wealthy, and the place where the California gold rush started.
If they want to rename Sutter's Creek, I'm marching on the Amador County.
But this is what made California California, what made it a state, and what's hilarious to me hilarious in a sick way is the reason there's statues to Sutter is almost we feel bad for him. You know, it was this guy kind of got hosed. I mean, they discovered gold, everyone came, they took the gold. And he got nothing. And this reaction right now to just destroy all these things, to fracture, to go to the subgroup and pronounce yourself against the world and plant your flag. I mean, it's astounding to me how it's just quietly happening. I mean, we are in the midst of a cultural revolution, and yeah, there's conservatives who are mad, and yeah, a lot of people watch Tucker Carlson, but this is just, it's just happening every day. And you can look around and you can just see these things dissipating and they're, you know, disappearing. And even for those of us who thought this was happening all along, saw this coming, you could use it that way. It's still a mind-blowing thing to see the disconnects and, all of this happening kind of in broad daylight. Reminded of a real brief, and I'll shut up. Joseph Conrad has this line about, I think it's him, about when he realized he wanted to run away from home and go onto the sea and learn different languages and whatever. So he's on the sea, and he saw in broad daylight was a ship sink, right? Mm. A ship sinks because they come upon a ship that's sinking. All these guys are asking for help, and they rescue all these guys onto the ship, as many as they can, which is most of the crew, as the ship is sinking. And then they all stop and they look, and he said it was remarkable because it was a beautiful day on the ocean, and in front of us, this ship just sank and everyone could have died upon it, right? And the feeling that he describes, is that to me is exactly what's going on now. You're just watching ship sink, and it's just daylight, and everything's normal, and everything's fine. And yeah, some people are raising a hubbub, but it's just continuously happening in front of us.
Go on.
I was just gonna say, some of this in the inflammatory language of our time, I would submit that it's not an accident, and this is worth pondering, that the most nationalistic of the three countries that we discussed, the UK, the US, and France, that is France, is the one really standing up for its history and its past. There's something to that. We don't need to go all rah-rah blood and soil, but at the same time, I mean, there's something to be said for a sense of identity rooted in a people and a place, and finding some balance between that and between the greatness that is America's dedication to the propositions in the Declaration is what we're trying to seek for and seek a way forward to. Just an anecdote about France, which they always preach, solidarité and fraternité and égalité. I will reveal my privilege here. I had briefly a French nanny when I was growing up, and we visited her I adored her. And we visited her when I was an adult in France, and we had dinner at their place, and she, of course, was with a man for 20 years, and they weren't married, very French. They're married now, I think. But they had a couple kids. They lived in the burbs in France. And he was basically a labor union, government labor union lawyer. That's what he did. So he was didn't like America that much, didn't like Bush. This was in the Bush years. And two telling anecdotes. One, he was like, we were talking about the American Revolution and education and the French Revolution. And he's like, well, yes. I mean, the principles of the Declaration, but the French Revolution happened first. And I said, no, it didn't. And I had to correct him on the history. We were just out. He's a very sweet man, really not prejudiced, but it was just sort of in the air. We were at dinner and got bad service. And I was like, it was a really fancy restaurant. And I was like, oh, that's surprising. Took forever. That server was not very good. And he sort of leans over and he goes, it's because he's Arab. Yeah. I was just like, this sort of the epitome of a woke liberal in the United States who would never be caught dead saying any of that.
Oh, yeah.
In France. And I, this is not to say a good thing for nationalism because he was against the Arabs in a prejudicial way. But it's just interesting. It's an interesting country.
We don't give ourselves enough credit because we look around at the world. We see Amsterdam also having Black Lives Matter.
Right.
New
Zealand, huge marches where 0.5% of the population is black.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. No country has ever tried to do what we're trying. We're still trying to do it. No country.
This is where it's like, aren't we, for all the talk of decline, which is true, I mean, this is still leading. And it says something about, it's not in a good way, but that globalism comes from us and people are globbing onto this.
Right.
And woke capitalism comes from us too. Yeah.
It's all from us. It's all just, at this point, it's all just European continental nations.
Not only does the world speak English, but it speaks American. Yeah.
Yeah. Well, yeah. Alas.
Yeah. And God bless the French for that. I mean, that's exactly what Ryan's saying. I mean, that's of all the countries I could never live, my wife would never live.
Not the solipsism or the dislike of the Arabs, but
no,
depends on the Arab. But
most British.
No, I know
some of my best friends.
British lefties I know are more upset about the election of Donald Trump than they are about Brexit, which tells you something.
Still,
really,
yeah.
And France is the country that has been the most resistant to anglicizing its vocabulary.
Mm. Yeah.
I mean, that's partially their problem, but yes, it's a respectable problem.
Those neighborhoods, Chris Caldwell's first or second book.
Mm. Yeah. Was it on? Reflections on the Revolution in Europe. Yeah.
Mm. Yeah. Don't forget the changing demographic face of France and how they're simultaneously allowing it. So there's something in their psyche that is attention.
It's not all good.
No.
They're proud of their language, keeping their language pure. They have the famous society and then the statues. But at the same time.
Oh, yeah. They've got a real problem.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Open gun battles between Berbers and Chechens in three major French cities this week.
Yeah, I saw that one video with the car careening through the square. Berbers and Chechens going at it in France. Yeah, no, it's it's a whole different kind of bad neighborhood. We have ours in here in South LA and Baltimore and Detroit, in all of our big cities, really, with various forms of ethnic conflict. But it's a whole different game in Western Europe, that's for sure. And much as you say, David and James, amplified, worse in France than it is in the UK for sure. So these things are all mixed bags. Well, with that, I think we should wrap up. Thank you for listening to the Roundtable. If you want to learn more, visit our websites at AmericanMind.org, Claremont.org, and ClaremontReviewBooks.com. Don't forget to rate, review, share, and subscribe on Apple Podcasts or wherever you get your podcasts. Thanks to the production and engineering crew, Jake Gannon and Annalisa Lee. Thanks, everyone. Talk to you next week.
And the story goes like this. Matt, you don't know what you're talking about. I grew up in a very sheltered white community. And then I went out in the world and I discovered that racism exists. And it's bad. There's really bad people in the world. And so we need to protest. And you're just kind of like,
yeah.
That's very nice. I'm glad that you found out that the world is a brutal place and people have flaws and problems. And the comment section is the complete overturning of TV. Because the thing that people don't realize is they used to say television was the thing that was crazy and it showed you all this bad stuff. But in fact, it gave us a very clean cut view of the universe and you couldn't imagine these things existed. And so you blame the medium for causing it. Whereas people were just able to say things like, hey, why didn't you mention the race in this article? And 1,000 people do that here and 1,000 people do that there.
It's all the things that people used to yell at their TV that no one heard except their family.
Yes, exactly. Exactly.
Right. Now you can be the broadcast corporation and the old man yelling at the television at the same time. Conflict is not going away. And understanding that that conflict is just going to be a fixture of human life, whether it is fueled by imagination or by identity or both, is an important reminder.
That can't be. We all grew up watching Sesame Street. It can't be.
Are you saying, James, that the struggle is real?
The struggle is real. Matt, I grew up in a very sheltered Christian household, a pious Christian household. And I am shocked to report that when I left my house, I discovered that evil and sin are real. Mm.
This is now exclusively an ASMR podcast. Hey, guys. This is the sound of my beard.
Is he touching the microphone?
Should we have a no touch rule?
Really? Yeah, no touching.
That's
no touching
not socially.
No touching anything.